Hi, dear student friends. Today we are going to discuss about the fourth module of electrical technology and safety. The fourth module mainly consists of circuit breaker and its function, the arc phenomenon, the method of arc extinction, the types of circuit breakers, and fuses, different types of fuses, and MCB, ELCB, faults in power system, and lightning. So first of all, we are going to see what is a circuit breaker. As we all know, the electrical power system consists of three parts: generation, transmission, and distribution. So first we have to generate electricity in power stations like hydro, thermal, nuclear, and all. And the generated power in these power stations or generating stations has to be transmitted through transmission lines, and maybe it will reach in substations in local area. From the substation, we have to distribute that electrical power to the final consumers like us, home appliances or industries, something like that. So during this network, we have to protect this switchgear or the apparatus or electrical appliances which is used for various purposes, because they are very costly heavy equipments, like the generators in the generators or alternators in the power station, the big transformer, power transformers, and the various allied appliances, the control equipments in the power stations, control equipments in the substations or receiving stations. So these are all equipments are very costly. And most of the equipments, generators, transformers, are all made up of copper. So if any abnormalities comes, we have to protect these equipments from these abnormalities, like maybe due to lightning, high voltage, maybe due to lightning or short circuit or line to line fault, line to ground faults. Different faults will be there. So we have to protect these equipments. For that, we have to use an equipment that is called a circuit breaker. It is has the same function of fuse, but fuse has the limitation that fuse can only interrupt or fuse can be used for very low voltage, and it cannot be used for high power systems and all. So circuit breaker, the definition itself says that it is a piece of equipment which can make or break the circuit either manually or automatically under normal or abnormal condition. So we can make means switching on, or break means switching off the circuit, either manually like a switch we can operate, or automatically. Automatically is nothing but under abnormal condition. If a fault happens, if a short circuit happens, if a lightning happens, we cannot go and switch off the circuit breaker like a switch. What we do for that, it has to be operated automatically. For that, it has associated with a relay will do that function. Automatic detection of the fault current, and the relay will give the information to the circuit breaker, and circuit breaker contacts will be opened. That is under abnormal condition. So you can see a picture of circuit breaker. Here I have shown an oil circuit breaker, and this is the picture. It will look like this in substations or power station. You can see this. So it has two contacts, fixed contact and moving contact. In the normal condition, these contacts are kept closer, like this. It is closed. When a fault occurs, the relay will give information, and the moving contact will be separated from the fixed contact. There, that time an arc will happen, like, you know, when you are switching off a light, small spark will be there. That is for small current. It is of heavy current in terms of 1000 amps. So that arc has to be extinguished by a medium. So different mediums are used for extinguishing the arc. Based on that, different circuit breakers are there. Now the operating principle is simply, we can say it has two contacts, as I mentioned, fixed contact and moving contact. And the moving contact will be separated from the fixed contact if any fault occurs. And this is what the picture you can see. The circuit breaker is connected to a transmission line or bus bar. This is called a circuit breaker. It has the contacts. This is called the moving contact, and this is a fixed contact. It will be closed like this under normal condition. If any fault happens, what will happen? The relay coil, this is the relay coil. So relay coil will get, or relay coil will get energized, and we close this switch. If the relay closed this switch, the relay coil is closed, and the trip coil will get energized. This is a battery, so trip coil will get the power and trip coil will get energized, and normally closed circuit breaker contact, that is the moving contact, will be separated from the fixed contact, and that faulty section will be separated from the healthy section. Now, as I told you, if the contacts are separated, there will be an arc formed, and this arc has it depends upon three things. You can see the degree of ionization, length of the arc, and cross section of the arc. You can see this is the moving contact, this is the fixed contact. When it is separated, there is an arc, and arc is mainly depends upon the degree of ionization. The air between these two plates got ionized, so the ionization degree is very important. So if it is more ionized, then the arc exists more, and like that. And length of the arc, if length is very less between these contacts, the arc will continue. If we are increasing the length, what will happen? The arc resistance will be increased, so arc cannot persist, arc will extinguish. And also the cross section of the arc, it is the arc resistance increase with the decrease in the cross section area. So if the cross section area is less, the arc cannot persist along. Now, to extinguish this arc, we have two methods. Mainly it is classified into two, that is high resistance method and low resistance method. In this high resistance method, the resistance of the arc is increased by various techniques, and in low resistance, the arc resistance is decreased by various techniques. In high resistance, it is mainly employed in DC circuit breaker and low capacity AC circuit breakers. The low resistance method is mainly used in AC circuit breaker because they are using another technique called zero low current or zero crossing only they are extinguishing. Zero crossing is only possible in AC circuit breakers or AC current, because the nature of the current is alternating. So zero crossing will be there in AC only, but in DC there is normal, you know, fixed, there is no zero crossing. So this low resistance or current zero method is employed in AC circuit breakers. Now we come to high resistance method. There are four methods to extinguish the arc by increasing the resistance. First is lengthening the arc. As we know, the contact is separated, or the contact length, the length between the fixed contact and moving contact is increased. What will happen? Normally the arc resistance is increased and it cannot persist. That we know. If you are inserting a fuse, when the fuse carrier comes closer to the contact, then only the arc will be there. If you are moving, the length is increased, arc cannot persist. So the same thing is happening here. Next thing is cooling the arc. Cooling helps in deionization. So degree of ionization is the concept applied here. See, if you cool, what will happen? The electrons movement will be reduced. So deionization happens. So arc cannot persist. And reducing the cross section, as you know, the cross section of the area, I mean cross section of the arc is reduced, the arc resistance is increased as Ohm's law, R is equal to rho L by A. So area of cross section and resistance is inversely proportional, so arc cannot persist. And the last method is splitting of the arc. The splitting of the arc also is a method, you know, one arc is splitted into two, three, four number of series of arcs, thereby the arc resistance can be increased and the arc can be extinguished fastly. In the low resistance method also we have four types. First one is lengthening the same thing. The dielectric strength of the medium is proportional to the length, so the gap is increased, that the dielectric higher dielectric strength of the medium, so thereby the arc is extinguished. The second method is high pressure. So here what is happening, the increased density of particles due to high pressure can create a deionization effect, thereby the arc is extinguished. Cooling, as usual, the same thing. What is happening, the dielectric strength between the contact is increased by cooling the arc, thereby the arc is not persisting. Blasting, the blast effect is nothing but the ionized particles may be swept, we just push away by using this blast effect, thereby the arc cannot persist. Now we are coming to some important terms in the circuit breaker. Arc voltage. Number one is arc voltage. It is nothing but the voltage that appears across the conduct of the circuit breaker during the arcing period. If we install or if we connect an altmeter across the contacts of the circuit breaker during arcing, what is the voltage that it measure? It is nothing but arc voltage. Next one is the restriking voltage. You can see the transient voltage that appears across the contacts. See, this is the contacts at or near current zero. At or near current zero, the voltage is nothing but the restriking voltage. You can see that. And recovery voltage is the normal frequency RMS voltage that appears across the conduct of the circuit breaker after final arc extension. Now, as I told you, the different types of circuit breaker is mainly based on the medium which is used to extinguish the arc. The first one is oil. If the oil is a medium to extinguish the arc, we say it is oil circuit breaker. Air is a medium, then air blast circuit breaker. SF6 is nothing but sulfur hexafluoride. It is an electronegative gas. Electronegative gas, nothing but, as you know, when the contacts are separated, the air loses its insulation property, or it ionizes. Air becomes conductor. So the SF6 gas is pushed over there. What will happen? The electrons, which is the cause for the spark, got attracted by this SF6 gas, or it is an electronegative gas, thereby the arc cannot persist. The last one is vacuum circuit breaker. This is what vacuum is used. Oil circuit breaker, which employs oil, air, high pressure air. Blast effect may be there, and sulfur hexafluoride and vacuum. Now we come to another topic called fuse. Fuse generally we are using in our house appliances, or maybe in industrial applications. Fuse is a short piece of metal. Actually, it is made up of maybe tin or lead or something like that. It is inserted in the circuit, which melts when excessive current flows through it. So if any abnormal currents more than the normal current flows through the circuit, the fuse breaking capacity is selected in such a way that the maximum current, it is just more than the maximum current. So if more than that flows through the circuit, the fuse wire melts and the circuit, the faulty section will be kept away from the healthy section. The fuse wire has some desirable characteristic, as we know. It should melt, the fuse wire should melt, so it should have a low melting point and high conductivity, free from deterioration and low cost. Now we have come to the different types of fuses which is used. Mainly we can classify the fuse into two: low voltage fuse and high voltage fuse. Low voltage fuse of different types: semi enclosed rewirable fuse, higher rupturing capacity catheter fuse, and HRC fuse with the tripping device. And high voltage fuse is again classified into cartridge type, liquid type, metal clad type fuse. But we are only discussing about the high rupturing capacity cartridge fuse. This is the most commonly used type of fuse in industrial applications. Here, if you see the high rupturing capacity fuse, you can see this is the contacts of the circuit breaker, and inside this contacts of the fuse, and inside this fuse you can see a fuse element, and fuse element is made up of probably silver, and this is the outer element, and this is the filling powder, probably it is a porcelain powder or something like that. So what is happening, it is made up of plaster of Paris or quartz or marble dust. The filling powder is made up of all these things, and it is acts as the arc quenching medium. Normally, at a normal condition, the fuse, through this, the current will flow. Under abnormal condition, this fuse element will melt and an arc is produced. And this arc is extinguished by the vapor. When the heat produced process vaporizes the melted silver element, the chemical reaction between the silver vapor and the filling powder results in the formation of a high resistance substance. Which helps a quenching of the arc. So what is happening actually, fuse element melts. Fuse element is made up of silver, and this silver, when it melts, it produces some vapor. The chemical reaction between the silver vapor and the filling powder that is made up of plaster of Paris or quartz, which results in a high resistance substance and which helps in the quenching of the arc. So the advantage is they are capable of clearing high as well as low fault current, they do not deteriorate, and they have high speed of operation. They provide reliable discrimination. Now, this is an important term, the difference between fuse and circuit breaker. The major advantage of circuit breaker as compared to fuse is the fifth one, replacement. As we all know, when the fuse melts, it needs some time to replace because we have to rewire the fuse. But for circuit breaker, when it tripped, after the fault is clear, we just reconnect it or we just switch it on, the circuit will be again connected back or the supply will be back. So that is a big advantage of circuit breaker as compared to fuse. So there is no replacement after operation. So just we can trip, once it is tripped, so we can re-energize the circuit very fastly. But in fuse, we have to again rewire or redo the wiring, or we have to connect again another fuse element for the operation. And the function, first one is a function, it performs both the detection and interruption. Fuse, there is no separate relay for detection or something like that. But circuit breaker, for detection, we need a relay. That is operation, comes under operation, inherently completely automatic. But circuit breaker requires an elaborate equipment that is called relay for automatic action. And braking capacity of the fuse is very small, where the braking capacity of circuit breaker is very large. And operating time is very small, for circuit breaker comparatively large, and replacement as I discussed. And this is called miniature circuit breaker. Every home, a newly built home, has this miniature circuit breaker. This is what a miniature form of the circuit breaker, which is used in the power system. It also has the same fixed contact and moving contact. Nowadays, we use MCB in low voltage electrical network instead of fuse, because fuse may not sense it, but miniature circuit breaker does it more reliable way. And we can, if a fault happens, we can again rebuild the circuit without much time. So everybody is using this miniature circuit breaker in their houses. Another safety equipment in house is ELCB, earth leakage circuit breaker. This is a very necessary safety equipment, which is has elaborate applications in houses or workshops or any industry, any other places where electric shock can be the death due to electric shock or the fat or any type of injury due to electric shock can be minimized by the usage of this earth leakage circuit breaker. It is nothing but from your house, from your any contacts in your house appliances or any circuit. If the electric current leaks through any medium, through maybe your body, it becomes electric shock. Through any leakage, it will detect and the circuit will be open. So, if you are touching in the iron box or checking the heat, that time the earthing is not proper, we'll get electric shock. So that time what will happen, through our body, the electricity pass through the air. That time the earth leakage circuit breaker detects and the circuit will be opened, you will be safe. Otherwise, you may lead to a fatality. It can be lead to a fatality also. Basically, the circuit breaker consists of three coils and a core will be there. The three coils will be surrounded, wound in the core, toroidal core. It has primary coil, secondary coil, or we can say it is phase coil and neutral coil. The third one is the searching coil, and it is associated with the button, and this is the load, this is the supply. Now, under normal condition, the phase coil and neutral coil is wound in such a way that it has the same current flow through this winding, but it in opposite, it will produce opposite MMF, and therefore the net MMF in the toroidal iron core will be zero. But if a earth leakage happens, the current through the phase and neutral will be no longer be equal, or there will be a difference. So the phase current will be more than the neutral current. So the MMF produced by the windings will not be the same. So what will happen? There will be a net MMF excess in the toroidal iron core. And the net MMF, if the core will link in the surge coil, and MMF is changing in nature, so this MMF will produce an EMF in the induced terminal of the search coil. The search coil will produce an EMF. This EMF will turn the drive a current through a trip coil, and the trip coil will pull the contacts, and thereby the circuit will be open. This is how it operates. Now we come to another area, that is faults in power system. We know there are different chances of faults in power system, because you know there may be a chance of failures, and maybe due to lightning surges, or maybe due to short circuit, maybe due to ground fault, internal faults, external faults, various faults can happen. So mainly the fault occurs, excessive current flows, and it damages the equipment. This is the main problem. So for that only we are using relay, circuit breaker, and so many other protective devices. Generally this fault current is nothing but a abnormal current, more than the normal current. So this is fault current. We can classify the fault into symmetrical and asymmetrical fault. Symmetrical fault is nothing but the three phase line touch together, and it will produce the same current in the all three phase lines. It is called symmetrical fault. Asymmetrical fault is nothing but the line, if one line touches to the ground, is because of the high wind or because of any reasons, one line breaks and it touches to the ground, it is called line to ground fault. And if one line breaks and it touches to the other line, it is called line to line fault. If both lines and breaks and it touches the ground, it is called line to line double line to ground fault. So these are the three asymmetrical faults in the system. Now the faults in power system may be because of the weather conditions, as we know, maybe because of heavy rain. Kerala is experiencing heavy rain during June, July, August, and all heavy winds and salt deposition. All these things, because of all these things, the lines can break, or maybe trees fall on the transmission line, trees fall on the line, distribution line. All this can cause. Next is equipment failure. Equipment failure may be generators, motor, transformers, all these things due to malfunctioning or due to aging or due to maybe insulation failure. All these things, the equipment failure can happen. And human error, maybe voluntarily somebody is doing something, or maybe by mistake, selecting an improper rating of equipment devices, forgetting metallic or electrical conducting parts after servicing. All these things can create these problems. Now we are coming to overall. What do you mean by overvoltage? Is nothing but the voltage more than the normal voltage. And a voltage surge is nothing but transient voltage, is nothing but sudden rise in voltage. Immediately the voltage rises more than the normal voltage. That is called a transient, or we can say it is a voltage surge. It can happen. There are several instances in the power system, especially in the transformer, transmission line, insulators, can subject to overvoltage, maybe due to sudden switching on, switching off, that can create a wave back, or maybe the overvoltage maybe can be because of lightning also. The causes of overvoltage may be, we can classify into internal cause and external cause. The internal causes is basically it is because of switching surges, insulation failure, arcing ground and resonance. External causes is because of lightning. Now we concentrate on lightning. What do you mean by lightning? Lightning is because of the charged cloud, or lightning definition itself says that the electric discharge between the cloud and earth, between the cloud and earth through a medium, maybe a tower, or maybe a long tree, maybe a mobile tower, or maybe a long constructional structure, or like that. So between the cloud and earth, or between the clouds, two clouds will be there. So a positively charged cloud and negatively charged clouds comes nearby. Between the clouds there will be a charge transformation, or between the charge senders of the same cloud. So all these things, it is called lightning. So how these clouds got charge? As we know, lightning is a huge spark. The cloud, when the clouds are charged to such a high potential, with respect to air, and this how the cloud got charged because of the friction between the air and the tiny particles of water causes the building up of charges. Like, and we can see a simple example. If you take a comb, if you rub that comb in our hair, and we know that piece of papers are attracted by that comb, that is because of the charges. So when the clouds got friction between the air particles and the tiny water particles, when the drops of water are formed, the large drops becomes positively charged and the smaller drop becomes negatively charged. When the drops of water accumulate, they form cloud, and hence a cloud may possess either a positive or negative charge depending on the charge of drops of water they contain. The charge on the cloud may become a great that may discharge to another cloud or to earth, or maybe inside the charge centers. All these things can happen, and it can create high voltage that can damage the things. Now, you know, a direct or indirect lightning stroke on the transmission line can produce up to 2000 kilovolt in 1 microsecond. It's very fast. So the traveling wave produced due to lightning surges will shatter the insulators. It can damage so many things. As you know, the waves, it can damage the windings of the transformer, because the windings is made up of copper. Copper is a very good conductor. So when a lightning happens, it immediately catches the winding of the transformer, the generators, and it can produce a possible damage. And in arc initiated in any part of the power system by the lightning stroke, the arc will set up in a very disturbing oscillation in the line, so it can completely damage the equipment in the line. Now we have to arrest this lightning. So this is a simple lightning arrestor. So lightning arrestor is a protective device which is used for protecting the equipments from this thing. So we can see a lightning arrestor. It is also called surge diverter. It's a protective device which conducts high voltage across which conducts a high voltage surges on the power system to the ground. So this is a spark gap is produced over here, and there is a non-linear resistance over there. So the action is like that. Under normal condition, the lightning arrestor is off the line, that is conducts no current to earth, or gap is non-conducting. That gap is selected in such a way that under normal condition, the gap is not sufficient to create a spark. On the occurrence of an overvoltage, if lightning happens, air insulation across this gap breaks down, and an arc is formed, providing the low resistance path for the surge to the ground. In this way, the excess charge on the line due to surge is harmlessly conducted through the arrestor to the ground, and the remaining parts will be safe. So this is the simple working principle of the lightning arrestor. So we have different types of lightning arrestor, mainly rod gap arrestor, horn gap arrestor, multi gap arrestor, expulsion type arrestor, and valve type arrestor. That's all. So we have come to the conclusion. So in this fourth module, we have discussed mainly the circuit breakers, the arc phenomena, the high resistance, the methods of arc interruption, that is high resistance method and low resistance method, and the different types of circuit breakers, and the fuse, and the desirable characteristic of fuse, and the different types of fuse, mainly HRC fuse we have studied, and MCB and ELCB, the difference between fuse and the circuit breaker, the working principle of ELCB, the faults in the power system, and the different types of faults, and overvoltage we have discussed, and lightning we have discussed, and different types of lightning arrestors also we discussed. Thank you. I hope you have enjoyed the video. Thank you so much.